before we talk a little bit, I suppose, about Franklin Covey's take on it, it might be helpful, I suppose, to give you a little bit about who I am, my story. So I'm a father, I'm a son, I'm a brother, I'm a friend, I'm a widow of three kids, I'm a football coach, I'm a performance consultant with a management organisation. So I fill lots of different roles in my life, not all of them as well as I'd like to fill, but I'm battling away. I suppose in terms of life journey, Carl Jung talked about the four stages of life and where we are. I'm certainly going through the athlete phase. I think you've pretty much picked up on that already. At one stage, Sean Boylan deemed me good enough to give me about three matches with the Meath team and quickly figured out the athlete wasn't there. You know, that famous piece you can't put in, but God left out. And since then, I've gone on to the statement stage and I had a successful business career. The lesson in the business career, I thought, was that when my wife was very ill at 37 years of age and there was lots of zeros behind the bank balance and a number in front of it, it didn't really matter. And that was the lesson that I learned out of that, and it brought me to the third stage of my life, which is, I suppose, the stage where you're trying to figure out what you're going to give back and what becomes really important and that what's your ultimate goal. And it's somewhere in there too, how can I help other people and how do you leave some sort of a legacy? And that's the stage of life I'm at, the second half of life, which is described by someone better than me at one stage. We spend the first half of our lives trying to, you know, chasing it, and the second half of our life sort of trying to understand what the hell we were chasing in the first place. So that's where I'm at today. Just to give you a brief, quick move, I suppose, of Franklin Covey. We are the largest behaviour change company in the world. We work with lots of teams and organisations, primarily in the business space, but not exclusively. Work a lot in the education space as well. I look after and represent Franklin Covey here in Ireland. We would train in a given year. Sorry, is anyone familiar with Stephen Covey and Seven Habits of Highly Effective People? Anyone? Any hand up? Anyone that's okay? Super. So you guys are going to come up before it's finished, and we'll go through the seven habits if that's okay, and you can teach me. We train in any given year approximately 1 million people across the globe. So we're pretty big at what we do. We spend a lot of money on research around people, behaviours. Our mission statement is to enable greatness in people and organisations everywhere. Key words is greatness and enable. And what we believe, and it's a core foundation of what we believe, is that people have greater potential than they produce. And what's that about? How do we release that potential? How do we get that in? Everybody gets up every day to come to work or to come to training every night with the intention of giving their all, of doing their best. And something happens in between that stops that. And we believe that's often the management, the leadership, or the organization actually gets in the way. Well, we try and help organizations to get out of their own way and to try and find that unleashed potential. And a simple analogy is we believe people typically operate somewhere around 50% of their potential. And if you imagine if your car was going at 50% of its capacity or your computer systems are going at 50%, you'd have a big problem and you'd be jumping up and down and you'd be trying to fix it. But yet with people, we struggle with that mentality. We struggle with that piece. So that's what we do. You've came across us probably through the seven habits, but there's lots of other stuff. We have 28 different training programs. We operate in organizations. You probably see us a lot in airports these days because we have a lot of books out. Ironically, what book would you think is the most popular one at the minute? It's the Seven Habits for Teenagers. That's the space. That's where the struggle is at the minute. And so one of the hardest jobs of being a coach, we're all a coach, is trying to coach and lead your own kids. That's the first one. These are some of the organizations we work, just a flavor of some of the organizations we work in Ireland. We work typically at leadership level and mid-management level, and you can get a sense of who these companies are. And they bring us in typically because they're having some people problems. Typically because they're looking to get a better result, they're looking to achieve something they're not getting, and they're trying to get under the skin of what's happening. What we usually find when we get into an organization is the problem you're told is not actually the problem. Underneath, there's layers and layers and layers of digging to try and find out actually what's the true problem. This is what every organization, in fact, it's what every team, in fact, it's what every family looks like. We're all operating in a system similar to this. We're all trying to achieve some sort of a result that we see there. That's what we're all trying to go. You're all here today for some reason that you're trying to achieve some results in your life or in your teams, in your sports teams, or in your job. And what we go through in all that space, we go through various things. We've all got stakeholders and client needs in our family. We know who they are. We've got a vision and purpose. Might not always be stated, but we clearly have. And then we get down to strategy. And your sports team today has a strategy. What are they trying to do? What's the systems and processes we put in place? And what's the culture we're trying to drive? And in the middle of all that, that's what you have. They're people. And nothing really happens. We believe you get no great change in any team until you get behavior change. That is probably the most difficult thing to do. So we operate in a very, very difficult space. We spend a lot of our time in that space trying to help teams drive from the strategy they've designed to actually getting the outcome they want. So for your team for the next year, you've got a thought or process in your head what you're going to try and do. But the challenge is actually, how do we get the people to behave differently in it, or else we're going to get the same result? And that's not easy. I don't know how you find behavior change, but I find it pretty tough. So we've got some models around how we believe we get sustainable behavior change, and we're going to talk a little bit about that today. The key components of today's, I suppose, talk are around the areas of what I mentioned about how to build a high trust culture. And a high trust culture is two key words in that sentence, trust and culture. So a definition of culture. What do you guys believe culture is for you? Does anyone want to shout out what culture might be?
The way you do things.
The way you do things. Anyone else? Excellent. So the way you do things is absolutely in there, which is basically is how the collective behavior of your people, how your people show up every day. It's not what you tell me it is, it's what I see and what I hear. It's the nature of those relationships, and it's into the Pat Daly space. It's what are the values that actually people are actually putting out there? What are they at? I want to share something with you today. I made a mistake last year. In fact, I made lots of them, but I made one key mistake last year in that value space. And before the end of the session today, I'm going to share with you what that mistake was and what the learning for me was in that space. And I think what I want you to take away is that learning for yourself around what this is going to be. Hopefully you'll find something in that. What we know about great cultures, and we work with organizations around the world, and we help them design culture, is that they have to be created intentionally. Because if not, what happens is a culture will create anyway. It'll be created by the freestyle behavior of what people will bring in, typically by the most dominant voices. They will determine the culture you're going to have. And what you've got to decide is actually, what's the culture that you want in your team? What's the culture you want in your club? What's the culture you want in your county? Don't let people own that. You've got to sit down and actually be really intentional about what you're trying to do in that space. And it's a great quote from the basketball coach, Adolf Rupp, and he said, whenever you see the man on the top of a mountain, you can be quite sure he didn't fall there. It's pretty true. And it goes back to that intentionality piece of how did we get there. So the question that you guys are probably here to try and figure out is, so how actually do you go about building a culture? Why is it important and how you go about doing it? We have a very simple premise that winning cultures are built simply on a foundation of just two things. Two simple things. One is you must have effective individuals. And it's at the core of everything we believe in that change has to start from the inside out. That's not always palatable, because I like change, but I'd like you to go first, and I'd like you to go first. But I think change is great, it's wonderful, but just don't push me into it. Okay? So the first challenge is, how do we build change from the inside out? And the second challenge is, how do we build credible leaders? Today, obviously, this is a business presentation in terms of that was the context it's taken from. But I want to be loose with the terms of leader. A leader is a coach, is a manager, is a teacher. So how do we build effective individuals, in your case, maybe effective players, and how do we build credible coaches? There are the two key things we must focus on to build a winning culture. Within that space, if you want to build a great culture, your first focus has to be on the individual behaviors. What are we looking for people to do in that team or in that group? What does that look like? Because Stephen Covey said, and it goes back to that system I said to you earlier on, that everything starts with the individual, because all meaningful change comes from the inside out. You can't get systemic organizational change without changing the individual first. The minute we look at the big picture and we start focusing on that, we've got to go back to people that are in the center. That's how culture starts. So if you want to build a great culture, leaders are the second key point in that. But the first of all is start with the individuals in it. So let's have a quick look. I'm going to build a case here for you. Or you're going to help me build a case. So I'm going to ask you for the next 10 minutes, if you can work with me. We're trying to go through. We would work on the trust program we have with teams we work with across the globe. We would typically work over a two-day basis on a workshop of teams. And then we'd work on a 12-week coaching follow-up. So this is pretty big. And the reason for that is, what we're doing this morning is a sheep dip. We're dipping you in, and we're dipping you out again. Are we going to affect behavior change here today? No. It'd be a dream if we thought that. But could we affect mindset change? Yeah, that's quite possible. We could change something that's going on about how you see something, your paradigm of how you see it. So what we're going to do is just look at the case we've built for trust, and I'll give you pieces out of that program. And the reason we do it over a two-day program is because people have to reflect seriously over 2 days and work through what trust means to them and practice the behaviors. Because behavior change doesn't happen in an instant. We wish it did, but it doesn't. We've got to work at it. So this morning, we're going to give you some pieces of what trust looks like. So I just want you to go inside for a moment, inside your own head. Great space to be. We spend most of our days inside our head, 66,000 thoughts a day. Most of us go through it. Haven't counted them all, but that's what I believe they tell us. And that 66% of those are negative. Well, there's an interesting one. Hardest job when you're working as a sports psychologist with a team is trying to turn that 66% down.
That's the hardest job. Most of us struggle with that piece. What do our thoughts look like? So what I want you to think about, first of all, who do you trust in your own life? Just pick one person in your mind straight away. Put that picture in. Who do you trust most? Who do you trust to do your job when you're not around? Who, when you go away on holidays, can you say, actually, will you look after that for me? I want you to think about, who do you trust with your PIN number? I want you to think about, who do you trust to look after your dog? Maybe who do you trust to look after your kids? I don't know which comes first. So who in general do you trust? And it'd be interesting to see how many people you've got in your mind that you see, actually, yeah, they're people that I can explicitly trust in my life. So just before we go any further, real quick, I'm going to take a minute on this. Just I want your definition of trust and why it's important at work and why it's important in sports teams. So if you just turn to the person on your right and just introduce yourself and give your definition of trust. I'll give you 30 seconds and off you go. Okay, folks, I'm going to pull you back in the room. I'd love to spend another 10 minutes on that. I'm going to pull you back if we can. So you can start to get a sense of how this would look like if we were doing a full workshop on it, where we'd be going here. And we'd be actually sitting down and be looking at your definition of trust, and we'd also be looking at the people that you trust in your life and why all of a sudden, oh, we've just raised trust. See, trust is only an issue. It's a bit like air. It's only an issue when we don't have it. It's the same thing. We don't ever think about it, but in actual fact, it's under the surface. It's always there. Amy Cuddy wrote a great book, and she's a lot of TED Talk, if you ever see her as well, but her view on it very simply is that every time we meet somebody new in our lives, we have only two questions. Can I trust you, and can I respect you? And every time a new coach walks into a team at the start of the year in January and introduces himself, the underlying question for every player in that squad is, can I trust you? Now, no player is going to stand up and say, hey, can I trust you? And who doesn't believe they're not trustworthy? A takeaway line from today. We trust others by their behaviors, but we trust ourselves by our intentions. Think about it. We always know our intention is okay, but we only judge others by their behaviors. So, in an organization, we challenge you in terms of where you were, what type of organization, what type of team would you want to work in, what type of culture space would you want to be in. So I'm going to get that group over on that side, on the left hand side of the room. I'm just going to get you to stand up, please, if you wouldn't mind. Okay? And while they're standing up, is there anyone here today from Mattock Rangers? No, thank God for that. Okay, we've got one. Okay, so you guys are all part of the Mattock Rangers senior squad for 2018. Okay? Happy with that? Okay, here's your squad, here's your coach, he's just come into you. Okay, this is your coach, this is how he operates. So he's pretty much old school mentality. He's pretty much got a command and control approach. He uses carrot and stick, but if he had a choice, he prefers the stick. Only tool he has is a hammer, so his every problem is a nail. He demands absolute compliance. Praise is not on the agenda. He's not really looking for feedback because he's quite egocentric. He blames and badmouths others both when they're there and when they're not there. And he skirts the real issues. Okay. 10 seconds, turn to the person next to you and just tell him immediately, what's it like to work on that for that guy? Turn to the guy next to you, just tell him, what's it like to work for him? Okay, guys, the good news is you can sit down, right? But you're starting to get a picture of what it's like to work for. Okay, nobody here from Tara Rocks, no? Another club in Ireland. I was looking at the unusual names. We could have picked the Fighting Cocks. We could have picked the Starlights. There were so many of them. But anyway, Tara Rocks. So can we get this side to stand up, please? You've got Tara Rocks. And you've got a new coach in for 2018. And here's how he works with you. So he treats people as people first. He's very respectful towards you. He practiced transparency and authenticity, so he's been real and genuine, congruent with you. He's interested in developing your character and you as a human being. He collaborates and communicates if you're an underage player with your parents. He includes everyone in the circle. He sets up support systems for your studies at school. He sees lots of untapped potential, and he wants you to play with that freedom. He's asking you to release that potential. He understands the importance of your intrinsic motivation, not his stick. It's your intrinsic motivation. He talks straight to you, and he'll confront an issue if he sees it, and he's constantly seeking feedback on how he can improve and how the management team can improve. Okay, 15 seconds, turn to the guy next to you and tell him how that feels. What's that like to be part of his squad? Sorry. Okay, guys, yeah. Okay, so we're getting a sense. Now, I think we'd all be liars if we didn't recognize both coaches in there. At some stage in our careers, we've came across them. If not in sports teams, we've came across them at work. We've came across it. It's out there. We often get called into an organization, the problem with a team. So the problem isn't the team at all. The problem is the guy leading the team. And he's complaining he can't get stuff out of his people. Really. What would you think the results are in both teams? What would you think the differences are? How do team meetings operate in Mattock Rangers as against Tara Rocks? What's player engagement like? If you're in an organization, any large organization now particularly, there's a company called Great Places to Work. They're an assessment company, an American company. They do a really good job. And they go around and they assess organizations on two key things, culture and trust. Trust being 66% of their measures of how good an organization is. Think about that. We got a lot of work out of it because we're brought in to help the companies to develop culture and trust. Great places to work. What about great teams to play in? What's the level of engagement like in a great team to play in? What's the level of culture and trust that are driving that? What's morale like in a team, good and bad? What's player ownership like? What sort of leadership are we going to get from the players? What's the energy that they're going to create? Pat Daly uses the line, it's a good line, that every team is an energy system. And the energy system will be defined by that type of coaching, that type of style. What's the level of creativity? How much do these guys feel the freedom that they can go and play and express themselves? What's the spirit like, and are we getting the potential? Now we're starting to understand what trust looks like in a team. And when you see a team underperforming or collapsing, my view, the underlying issue is there's a trust problem. But you just haven't brought it to the surface. It's the piece that's underneath it. And so if we look at it from a player point of view, everyone turns up to work each day with all of these options. I'm about to quit. I've had enough of it. Or I'm going to stay and be obedient. So I'm actually going to quit but stay, the worst type. I'm going to be somewhere in the middle. I'm going to comply and cooperate. That's what you're going to get out of me. Peter Drucker said the biggest sin in management is to do nothing in that middle level. Just leave them. It's a crime. Or do you really come committed to something? Or are you actually excited about what you're involved in? I'm going to ask you today, where are you as a coach in that space? How high up the ladder are you in that? And if not, why not? And that whole piece of how much we engage or commit to any team is what I call our discretionary effort. That's the piece we can decide to give or not to give. You guys look after teams of volunteers. Your players are volunteers. They're doing this for fun. They're doing this because it gives them some sort of sense of identity. It gives them some sort of sense of being part of a team. How much they're going to commit is going to be very much based on what you do in that space. How connected do you get to these guys in their body, their heart, their mind, their spirit? Because we're all made up of those four dimensions, all of us. We need the body to live. We need the heart to love. We need the mind to learn. And we need the spirit to leave a legacy. And if we don't address our players in those four areas, then really and truly, they're not going to give us that full level of commitment. And that's what trust looks like. That's what high trust and low trust like. If you want to end up down there, do the things the first coach is doing. Because eventually your players will vote with their feet. Eventually they'll vote with their effort. And people will say, what happened after? And nobody will say, it was lack of trust in that group. They'll say, oh, they didn't perform on the day. And as a coach said to me earlier, that's young lads. So you never know how they're going to turn up on the day. If you have a high trust team, you know how they're going to turn up in a day. It's a given. There's no question marks over it. It's So the question for you this morning is, which type of team do you want to be involved in? Do you want to be involved down here with Mattock Rangers or over there with Tara Rocks? Where are you at in that space? The chances are you're not all the way at the bottom. The chances are you're not all the way at the top. You're somewhere stuck in that middle. But if you want to be a really, really good coach and doing what you're doing, your job is to move that trust level up. Your job is to connect with those players in every single way you can to get the max of them out of it. So the premise for the next half hour of our conversation, we believe that the single biggest critical competency for leaders and coaches today is trust. That's actually the core piece. And our intention is to help you understand how we can develop, restore. Not today, we're not going to go into all that, but we're going to give you some nuggets to take away today on trust. I'll also stay behind after. I'm happy to share what we have. We've millions spent. The last version that we produced on this had a budget alone of $7 million just to produce the program. That's on research and development of what we do. So we know a lot about trust. That's our space. And the outcome today is that you'll have some understanding of what your trust looks like, because trust has to start with you. That credibility piece and how you build trust in relationships. Because we do know it's a soft virtue, but sometimes we don't have a framework or a tool to use with that. So let's have a quick look at this, and you can give me your
thoughts. I'd like to share a powerful insight I've learned while teaching the speed of trust to tens of thousands of leaders in over 40 countries. As a leader, your ability to create trust is the single most critical leadership competency needed in today's workplace. Now that's a bold statement. There are a lot of skills you need as a leader, but the most critical by far is the ability to create and sustain trust. Why is that? Think of water for a moment. Water is the vital substance that sustains all life on this planet. When it's there, everything flourishes and grows. When it's not there, everything withers and dies. Without water, there is no life. The same is true for trust. When there is no trust, relationships decay, projects fail, customers go to competitors, initiatives underperform, and work grinds to a crawl. But contrary to what most people believe, trust is not some soft, elusive quality that you either have or you don't. Rather, trust is a pragmatic, hard-edged, economic, measurable, and actionable asset that you can create. In fact, creating trust is something you can get good at, and far faster than you might have thought possible.
DCU did a study 6 or 7 years ago, and part of their study was around trust in organizations and the economic side of trust. And they found that a 36% increase in trust was equivalent to a 10% increase in salary. And yet most organizations will try and focus on how we're going to look at the performance piece, how we're going to pay people more. And as we get down to what we're at now, 5-6% unemployment, what I see in the organizations I go into, that those people are moving, typically not for much more of a salary. They're moving because of culture. They're moving because of trust, because somewhere else they feel more valued. And if you're in a competitive space and you're trying to attract talent, that's a real challenge at organizations today. So what is our definition of trust? We have a very simple definition. We like to keep things fairly simple. And we look at trust as being two sides, a competence side and a character side. The opposite of trust, we all know, is suspicion. The winning cultures piece, what we know about that is, these are the four key components we've learned from 30 years of working with organizations and teams. It has to be designed intentionally. We've talked about that. You have to have some sort of a framework that you put into the team that's going to build a common language. You can't just go loosely out, because what happens is you make it up as you go along. It mightn't be the perfect framework, but any framework. It's like a system of play. Do you put your team out without a system of play and say, make it up as you go along? No, you don't. You give them some tracks and some ground rules of this is how you're going to play. And then we go out and play with freedom. Culture is exactly the same. There must be some set of psychological contract of how we're going to ask people to behave. And finally, and this is a critical piece, if the leaders or the coaches at the top aren't sponsoring it, you won't get effective change. If we're brought into an organization to help them change something, and the support from the top is not there, the chances are it'll fall away. And we're often brought in by HR and say, come in, we've got a problem. But if we don't get the leadership buy-in, we'll step out. Because if the leader doesn't drive it, the same with a coach. If the coach isn't driving this culture, I could go into any club or any setup, And if the coach isn't behind this, forget it. We're wasting our time. So four key components to it. Conference today, the theme of the conference is, I think Pat Daly borrowed it from us actually. But the very basis of Franklin Covey's coaching stroke leadership model is a very simple model, and it's called the see, do, get model. And it brings all sorts of psychology in. CBT is behind it. Think it, do it, become it. If we're going to change something, we want to get a different result. And most of us are looking for some improvement in the result, or we're trying to solve a problem. This is typically where we focus. We focus at the behavior side. We look at a skill set. How can I give my team different skill sets? We actually believe change starts here. And in fact, if it doesn't start here, what we get is a temporary change here, but we won't get sustainable change. The hardest change is the mindset change. How do we change the mindset of an individual or a group? What's the mindset like in the group that you're working with? Is there room for improvement? And if we don't change mindset, is it really, really possible to get a different result? We don't believe it is. So our starting point is start with the individual and start with the mindset. So I hope you're ready and observant this morning. I'm going to get you to do a quick exercise for me here. On that page are numbers 1 to 54. All numbers are there. There's nothing missing. I promise, trust me on that. Okay? And I'm going to give you 30 seconds with your mental finger. And you're going to see how far you can get from number 1 to number 54 in sequence. Okay? Let's go. Can hear the countdown clock about to go. You have 5 seconds left yet. No pressure. Right, stand up if you got 54. No chance. Stand up if you got to 40. Stand up if you got to 30. Stand up if you got to 20. Stand up if you got to 50. Go on, stand up, yeah, excellent. Oh, look at this. Geniuses. Stand up if you got to 15. Stand up if you got to 10. Stay shamed and sit down if you didn't get to 10. Don't go anywhere. It's a challenge, isn't it? What makes it so difficult? What makes it so difficult? Well, the shapes are different, aren't they? Which makes it really difficult. But it's really hard to identify something, isn't it? I talked earlier on about the importance of frameworks in whatever you do. It's about giving people a framework to bolt onto. That's how you build a commonality in a culture, that everyone knows the framework we're working to. Imagine playing in the team without having that system of play. We don't know what we're doing. And so culture is exactly the same. It's been ran by freehand. Can people name it? If we got 10 people in the room to define the culture in your team, they can't do it because you haven't given it to them. See what I mean? So if you look at where the numbers were, all the ones were placed in a space, twos, threes, it all followed a pattern. It was easy to get if you knew there was a framework. But without the framework, it's a struggle. Now you've got the framework. So you're ready for 30 seconds. Let's see, can you improve? Go. Okay, stand up if you got a higher number. Ah, cool. Okay, sit down, so. Okay, stand up if your number went down. I just needed to know that, okay. So what's the learning? The learning is that if we've got a framework, people will learn much quicker, and they'll also have an understanding of what you're asking for. It's not loose, it's practical. It's something they can define. This is what we've learned. You must have a framework. It's critical. For effectiveness, the 7 Habits of Highly Effective People, who's been on the go for 25 years, it was written as a doctoral thesis around how people are effective in their lives. That's a framework for effectiveness. It's used across the world. If you ever have the pleasure of listening to Joe Schmidt speak at any event, and he does a lot of it, he'll mention two things. He'll mention the 7 habits of highly effective people, and he'll mention trust. There are the two key things Joe will reference all the time. Joe gets this, and he gets the reason behind the framework, why it's so important that your team has a system to work towards. So the question is, what framework do you give your team right now? Are you giving them a framework? The chances are you're not. You're probably giving them a framework to play with, a system of play, but you're probably not giving them a system to work with. This is one of our frameworks. This is the speed of trust. This is what we do. Trust is like the air we breathe. When it's not present, nobody really notices. But when it's absent, everyone notices. And you may not be able to control everything, but you can certainly influence certain things. And that certain thing is trust.
Early in my career, I reported to someone I didn't trust and who didn't trust me. I wasn't sure exactly why, and I was at a loss as to what to do about it. I could clearly see how this lack of trust negatively impacted everything associated with our relationship. What I quickly realized, however, was that no matter how hard I tried, I couldn't just manufacture a feeling of trust for this person. It was during this time that I discovered this profound insight. The feeling of trust is very often the result of a deliberate process of creating trust.
That's the intentional piece. How do we intentionally create trust? Are we hoping it's going to happen? Is that our strategy for this year? We're going to put our hands together and pray and hope that we build high levels of trust. I'm going to try and give you some framework to work in that space. We believe there's 5 ways of trust, and if we're working with an organization like Volkswagen, who've had a slight issue with trust, you can imagine where their issue has gone with trust, right? What's market trust like for Volkswagen after what happened? And we believe these are the 5 key areas that trust works in. For today, we're going to look at the self-trust and the relationship trust, but there are organizations we work with who want to look at trust from a perspective of all 5 ways. Like a drop of water in a pond, your personal credibility has an effect on every relationship you have and every team you work with. So trust is going to start with you. And the principle of credibility is what self-trust is based on. And the reason why there's a single drop of water is when a drop of water hits the pond, it creates a ripple. And it's a ripple outwards. You are that drop of water.
Imagine you're in a court of law. You've been called as an expert witness.
Dr. Farron, hello. Thank you.
And the lawyer
so
from the prosecution is attempting to convince the judge that you are a credible witness. What will she try to prove? The first thing is that you are a person of integrity.
Why don't you just tell us a little bit about yourself?
Certainly.
That you have good intent, that you're not trying to deceive or protect anyone.
To research and develop ways of preventing, treating, and curing diabetes.
Third, that your credentials are excellent.
Would you please tell us a little bit about your professional accomplishments?
I did my undergraduate advanced chemical engineering.
And fourth, that you have a good track record and are known for producing results.
In biochemical pharmacology.
Oh, thank you so much.
You're welcome.
Now the lawyer for the defense gets up.
Dr. Farron, your work is impressive.
And he's going to attempt to convince the judge that you're not credible.
How will your organization profit if you do indeed find a cure for diabetes?
Our organization.
Has the developed cure been shopped to any particular pharmaceutical company?
I'm not aware of any kind of agreement.
Do any of the pharmaceutical companies have interest in your organization?
Your credibility boils down to these 4 issues: your integrity, your intent, your capabilities, and your record of results. The first 2 are character issues. The last 2 are competency issues. I call these the 4 cores of credibility because your credibility rests upon your character and your competence. Take the core issue of integrity. In the 3rd round of the Italia Masters Tournament, tennis champion Andy Roddick was paired against Fernando Verdasco. It was match point in favor of Roddick. Verdasco hit the ball, the line judge called it out, and the crowd assumed Roddick had won the match.
The double fault call, it's all over. Oh, wait a minute, no, it's not over.
but Roddick pointed out to the umpire a slight indentation on the clay court, which showed that the ball had landed on, not beyond the line. Everyone was amazed. Roddick had made a call against himself, and as a result, he lost the point and he went on to lose the match. But he gained something far greater. He gained credibility and trust. How do you think the umpires are going to respond the next time Andy Roddick challenges a call?
Well, an extraordinary match to witness. He's won a lot of friends.
Well, he's such a great guy on and off the court, and what we saw there just typifies the young man.
I'll never forget the day an opposition coach in an underage match in Meath told the referee that a point he'd waved wide was actually over the bar against his team. It's the most unusual thing I've ever seen. His credibility went right up in my mind. I still see the guy, and the memory is always based on that one thing he did. It was clearly a point. The players knew it was a point. The referee got it wrong. He called the referee over and said that was a score. Big thing to do. That's the framework you're looking at. That's what we believe determines your credibility in terms of who you are. Can anyone tell me why the competence piece is above, at the top of the three? Why is that? It's visible. It's what people see. It's your track record. It's quite often the reason we get a job. We're brought in because we've had some track record of success. Or maybe we've had a qualification. We've got some PhD in something. It's the piece. Can anyone tell me why integrity is at the root of the tree? It's the foundation. Can we see integrity? Can't, because it's under the ground. It's the bit we can't see. And how we know when integrity is really there is when a storm comes. And we've had a few of them. Because that's what we know what's at the roots. Now we're starting to get the core of what people are at and trust. Why would you think intent is above the ground? Yeah, your actions. People can see your actions. But also because we also have the potential to actually tell people what our intention is. It's often the first thing we forget to do. Early on, I outlined what my intention was today. Because if we don't outline our intention, people will assign an intent onto us. And that may not be our intent. So it's really important, actually, to get your intent out there. What's your intent with the team you're working with this year? They should know that. They know exactly where you're coming from. Then they can start judging you on these areas. Every coach that comes into a club this year, think about it, how he's going to be viewed. He's going to be viewed. Is he capable? Is he good? Does he know what he's doing? Has he got the right drills? Can he figure out the system of play? Is he tactically good? Is he bright? But underneath that question that Amy Cuddy's asking, what they're really, really asking, the unconscious question, what's going on here? Can I trust him? Maybe a greater question for those of you that have kids is, can I trust my son with him? Is he going to develop my son or is he going to harm him? Will he be a good experience? Where winning becomes less of it. Winning is an outcome. But in actual fact, what's going to happen in that relationship? And a real basic question, an internal question. I don't want you to shout the answer to this one. But a real basic question is, do I trust myself? And do I give other people someone that they can trust? And that if you were to leave here today and you were to write your manifesto, what's a manifesto? Set of principles and things you're going to do, except when it's a political one. Then it's things you're never going to do, but you're going to tell people you're going to do it. So I can be trusted. And what I want you to think about is, I can be trusted. Can I be trusted under the four headings? How can I be trusted? Am I really clear about that? Can I give people somebody they can trust? Have I got the integrity? Is my intent in the right place? Or is it actually, you know, the biggest thing that kills teams is ego. Without a shadow of a doubt, the biggest challenge in every team is ego. Individual ego is what kills it. It's what kills it in coaching. Where the result for the coach becomes the number one. It's about his own ego. And what happens is then we struggle. And then we can't understand why guys aren't committing to me. Because it's all about you. So very quickly, 30 seconds, person beside you, or maybe another person you haven't spoken to. Just talk about how you might apply those four cores in your role on Monday when you go back to work, or in your team, and to share maybe some one reason why you can be trusted. Which of those four cores is the critical one to you? Right, off you go, 30 seconds. Okay, folks, going to bring you back in the room again if we can. I'd love to let you go with this. I'll be kicked out. Okay, it's starting to make some sense to you. It starts out as conceptual, and that's the problem with trust. It seems like a soft virtue. But in fact, underneath everything we do, it's right there. It's a driver. It's an unconscious driver. Was it Carl Jung, I think, said that until we make the unconscious conscious, we'll always believe we're in control of all our decisions and our faith. There's always unconscious drivers going on, things we haven't identified, reasons why we're doing things. And trust is one of those unconscious things going on in every team. And what I'll try to get you to, even as you spoke to the person beside you or around you, was to give them some sense of your intent. Because intents are critical. What are they? Indicator. Okay. What's it there for? Signal where you're going. Okay. Do you signal where you're going? Now, I came behind a few of you coming in here this morning, and I have to say, lads, could have been better, right? But do you actually signal where you're going? Because if you don't, just look what happens.
Sounds fresher, trivial, given, well, Saturday. So I could be able to go on tomorrow.
Daddy's going to be so excited.
That killed him.
Paging Dr. Palmer, Dr. Barbara Palmer, dial 452.
It's a funny taking it, right? But it is what happens when we don't signal our intent. So when we're unclear about it, what happens? Okay, so we've got a sense, a quick speed trip of what it looks like to be credible, why people should trust you, why I should want to work with you, why I want to be on your team. It's critical. It's part of your development as a human being and as a coach. I'm just going to very quickly show you a little bit what we know about relationship trust and how to intentionally build that with the players you have in your squad. So I want you just very quickly, again, go inside, 10 seconds, just think of a high trust relationship you have, a really high trust relationship, and think of the feelings that brings about. What does it do? Think of someone who's trusted you. Think of someone who's placed their trust in you, who said, I actually think you could do more. What does that bring? And then I want you to think about the opposite. I want you to think about someone you've worked with or been involved in a team with who showed a lot of mistrust in you, who showed a lot of suspicion in you, who doesn't seem to be confident in who you are or what you're doing. What feelings does that bring about? Sort of polar apart, isn't it?
I think trust is honesty, open communication, straightforwardness.
We all have those trusting sensors.
First of all, you try to get this gut feeling and try to be sensitive to it.
It's like, I don't know music, but if I hear a bad note, I think I can recognize it.
I know I can trust somebody if they look me in the eye.
They don't need to stare at me, but I can see when they're just shifty.
Blatant lying to my face.
Body language says a lot.
If they're a little too slick,
they're hiding something.
It takes years to earn a good reputation, but you can certainly lose it in a lot shorter period of time.
I like that one about if you hear a bad note, you might know music, but you know it. And that's what trust is. Trust is a feeling. It comes down to that relationship piece. It doesn't really matter what you're thinking, it's what you're feeling. Something in here is not aligned. It's a gut sense. And we talk about trust as being like a bank account. You've got to put emotional deposits and withdrawals in. The challenge is sometimes you can do lots of small deposits and then you can make one serious withdrawal. And that can affect everything and all your relationships. but it's like how much have you invested in the bank account? How much are you investing with your players in that emotional bank account? How much have you invested that they're going to do what you'd like them to do, what you want them to release that potential? Because that's what it's about. So if you're a follower, if you're a leader, you must have followers. And if you haven't got followers, you're basically just going for a walk in the park. Think about it. So to lead, you must be able to build that level of trust that people want to go with you. And if you've been fortunate in your life to have had one or two people that you've been able to follow, you'll know what I mean. You die for them. You'll do everything you're ever asked to do in that space. You don't need to take a shot at this. This is our model for 13 high trust behaviors. Okay, we've done a huge amount of research and stuff. I'm sure there are other behaviors, but when we drilled it down, these were the 13. You'll find this online. If you Google it, 13 high trust behaviors, Franklin Covey, you'll find it. When we'd work with a team over 2 days, these are the behaviors we drill down into. Not necessarily into all 13. What you actually ask the group is to identify individuals, what are the behaviors that they're struggling with? How can we help that individual improve the behavior? What's really beautiful about this is, it's a bit like those people who have children here, particularly small children, will understand that, you know, you're often guided on, don't criticize the child, criticize the behavior. What the cards allow you to do is to take the emotion out of the behavior. You're not accusing somebody of being a bad person, but you are saying to them, some of your behaviors here aren't working. We also look at our team index, where we'd actually look at the team and see, as a team, what are the two or three key behaviors in here that could be better? And it's a real wrestle. It's a real work in progress. It'll possibly leave a bit of blood on the wall. Good. Now we're getting some honesty. And that's how we start changing behaviors, when we start identifying the things and making people aware of what's not working. So we would ask the team, what's the key behaviors they want to focus on this year? What's the one or two things that team needs to work on? Not 13, but what's the one or two key things that if the team focused on those behaviors this year would make a difference to the results and the outcomes? And we've talked earlier on about the definition of trust being the confidence of somebody's character and competence, and the opposite of trust is suspicion. What we know when we go into teams, what we're more likely to see is the opposite of high trust behaviors. The chances are we're going to see what we call counterfeit behaviors. Okay, we've had quite a bit of it in the last year, if we think about it, in the financial sector. We've had counterfeit behaviors. We've had low trust behaviors. That's created a real problem for those organizations. And you can't talk your way out of bad behavior. You have to behave your way out of bad behavior. So what does the counterfeit zone look like? For every one of the 13 behaviors we've identified, there's 13 opposites. They're not pretty, but they're in your team. The challenge is, how do we pull them out of your team? Because when we get down to the behaviors, they're the things that are impacting on the performance on it. And the question is for you, as we're going to get close to wrapping up today, is how do you go out today and extend trust? Where do you start to extend your trust? Because if we don't start to extend trust, then we're going to have a problem. And it's primarily a matter of your heart. It's about your willingness, your ability to extend trust. I've met some coaches, some leaders that don't have that ability. They can't do it. They work from a low trust position. And typically a high controlling situation is where there's low trust in there. If you meet a coach that's highly controlled, the chances are there's low trust in behind that.
Concrete first to get some gravel, pop it in the mouth. Mix a mess of mortar, you add some add water, see the Mallaroonie come out, slurp, slurp, slurp.
Cement mixer, potty potty. Cement mixer, potty potty.
Who wants a bucket of cement?
Robert, kom je even mee stappen? Wat is dit? Deze schitterende wagen.
Oh, Eddie!
A rather humorous look at what low trust and what suspicion looks like in a team and where it's at. I'm going to wrap up. You guys have a circle of influence that you're in your teams and your organizations that you work in. And your challenge is when you leave this room is to bring people to the edge of that circle. And the only way we can bring people past that circle, in other words, past the comfort zone, and that's what we're trying to do, and every time we coach with every group, get them past that edge. It's the edge of discomfort. We must have built that level of trust behind. If you bring them to the edge and it's not safe, they won't go there. All human beings will recoil back into safety. If you've made it safe for people to take that risk and move, they'll go beyond that edge of influence. That's the edge you're working against. It's a dangerous place. That's your job as a coach, to bring those people to that edge based on the levels of trust you have. And your job in clubs and counties is to grow more coaches who bring people to that edge, who are able to coach themselves, coach their teams, and coach their counties. That's what we're looking to try to do. So speed of trust, the stuff is hereafter. I'm more than happy to share with anyone. I'm going to finish with these because these are sort of core where I'm at. All organizations and teams are perfectly aligned to get the results they get. Very few teams will accept that. You're aligned to get, the ingredients are in there to get what you get. And Stephen Covey added to that, he said, all organizations and teams are perfectly aligned to get the level of trust they get. The connection is absolutely there. Where do you want to be? What's the level of trust you want to have in your team or squad or club this year? Feedback is critical. Without it, you can't move forward. Is there a feedback loop in your team or your squad? Are you getting feedback? Who tells you whether you're trustworthy or not? Because what we know is in a room like today, you're all sitting here at a conference because you're looking to improve. You're looking to put some emphasis on what you're trying to do. You're looking to build some accountability in your team for people to take ownership and create some habits. But it gets stuck. And where it gets stuck is when you leave the room today. So you're trying to drive something, but it gets stuck there. How do I bring this down to a team? Because it's going to take a bit of hard work. How credible are you leaving the room today? And trust is the performance multiplier. That's the space. The mistake I made, the piece that I learned, was last year I worked with a squad. I didn't determine the values and the level of trust that were there before I went to work with them. I learned them during it and I had to leave it. And Jack Welch, famous CEO of GE, and he was known as a hard nut, he had a very simple performance matrix he used with his team and his people. And on the left-hand side was how you're performing and the results you're delivering. But then on the right-hand side was the values. And if you weren't delivering on those values, he didn't care how well you were performing, you're gone. And he called that values violation. And he said, if you really want to build a culture of high trust and values in your organization, get rid of a high performer who's not behaving in the way you've asked them to behave. Hope you've enjoyed this morning. I'm going to leave you with this. arrested this time next year and you're charged with delivering a high trust culture, will you plead innocent or guilty? Thanks, folks. Have a good day.